But hum.
Whatever you do, do not open that door. There's another bit right there from Gene Wilder. Peter Boyle with Love and Ray Romano. Great show as well. And Everybody Loves Raymond. Watch it flying out here on American Airlines. Let's show you what's going on around the country, kids. On this Tuesday, the night of the Latin Grammys, sunny skies down through Texas, all the way from the bottom of Texas to the top of North Dakota. Little rain to the right of North Dakota. Parts of North Dakota may see a little rain. To the west of the country, no problem. To the east of the country, no problems except down in Florida, a little rain. Northeast, we'll see little rough seas along the New England coastline from that hurricane that's going away. Miles and miles of sunshine. Miles Davis. We're going to put Miles out there today. Nice as it can be across the Northeast. Rough seas still from the chop from that hurricane. But other than that, it's kind of quiet around the country. We like quiet. It's quiet. It's too quiet. That's a quick look at the national forecast. Here's an early look at your weather.
Hi, everybody. I'm Hillary Howard. It is beautiful outside. Perfect September day with lots of sunshine. Oh, would you look at Washington, huh? I'm going outside today. Anyway, we're going to have a pretty day. Temperatures will be 77 to 82 degrees. Obviously, in the higher elevations, it'll be just a little cooler. And then same thing tonight. Tonight, we'll see a wide disparity in terms of temperatures. 48 in the higher elevations, 60 down along the water. Seven-day outlook looks sunny and dry, getting up to 81 today.
All right, Janie Jane, back to you.
Here we go, my friend. This is an autumn to remember for the cast of Everybody Loves Raymond. The show's moving into the lucrative world of syndication, and on Monday it will kick off its sixth season on CBS.
If you want me to help you, I'll help you.
Okay.
But if you're asking for my help, we got to do it my way, because it's the right way.
All right.
With the yellow.
I say with the yellow.
And nobody tells me what to do. I get to be in charge. I get to be the boss, all right?
All right, Dad, you're the boss.
I'm the boss?
Yes.
Good. You're fired.
Yeah, why would you do that?
It's really fun to, it's really fun to abuse Ray. It's
Ray really Romano is. And Peter Boyle, good to see you.
Good to see
Thanks
you.
Thanks for getting up a little earlier than normal
right.
this morning. Nice to have you in. Sixth season. Can you believe it?
Yeah, I try not to think of it because I don't believe it.
No?
So don't mention it.
Okay, just that once
yeah.
or twice. Is it true you played Vegas this summer just to sort
yes.
of get away?
Well, I still do stand-up, so when we're off, I like to perform still. I do Vegas like every 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
Ray hates Vegas.
No, I love Vegas. Yeah.
You weren't with him, I guess.
No.
But that's
the. I went to London and Paris.
Yes, a little more refined in your taste.
The real London and real Paris.
That's my favorite town, Vegas. Though you got to come next time, right?
Yeah, I am.
Hey, I got to ask you right off the bat. My mom always told me it's not too polite to talk about salary, but I've read this everywhere, so I have to say.
Your mom's right.
$800,000 an episode.
True. I don't even know if I get paid.
And a share of the syndication rights, which are just, you know, enormous. $35 million over the next 5 years. I mean, you are ka-ching, the money man.
You have to call my wife because, as far as I know, I don't even know if I get paid. Everything goes through her. I
just don't get paid in cash.
I have clean clothes and food.
Yeah,
that's
and,
all.
And nobody's, you know, parked outside your estate.
Do I have
the guards, the guards, they say, oh, it's you, Mr. Romano, you can come in.
I do this for the love of laughter.
Yeah. Not bad for a former mattress delivery boy, I guess.
Futon, yes,
right here in New York.
Where I grew
Peter,
up.
Peter, you were known mostly as a film actor. We were giving you some grief over there earlier.
Yes.
Mostly Frankenstein is what we remember.
Mostly with. Frankenstein.
Yeah. Go ahead, do it. Come on.
That's how he is on Monday morning.
Yeah.
On the set, so.
You're used to that,
exactly,
huh?
Exactly, yeah. Just before coffee.
That's right.
Do you like TV?
Do I like TV?
Yeah.
Yes, Jane, I do like TV.
Yeah, better than film?
No. Wait a minute.
I got it.
Wait a minute.
What?
Wait a minute. Four cameras is very. Very weird. I mean, look, there's four cameras.
Yes.
In a film, you usually have one camera, and you say, oh, I go that way.
Right.
See, and then when you have a close-up, the camera's actually close up.
But also live audience. You got live audience.
But the great thing is the live audience, and actually working with Ray.
Is it?
Because not only is he terrific, it's, like as I said, it's fun to abuse him.
You sort of take him under your wing, haven't you? I read that.
Well, We lived in the same apartment complex.
Yeah, I read
the first
that.
Year.
And you used to take him out on the town, all the Hollywood hotspots.
I took him out
spots.
On the town yeah. once. And I said, I know these people to run this place, the Sky Bar. We'll just drop in. And it was like a hot place in L.A. And I go and I have a Perrier, you know. I'm like the Perrier, the guys who partied a lot 30 years ago.
Yeah.
Well, so the first year we both, you know, both our families lived in New York. And we didn't know the show was going to stick yeah. around. So. Yeah. Yeah. We would commute back and forth, and
yeah.
it was my first time out in L.A., and yeah. you were the only guy I knew. And
I took you under my, yeah. my hoof.
And since then, my family's moved out there. Yeah. We live there yeah. now. Yeah. Yeah. But you still commute.
I still commute.
Are you surprised at all your success, the success of this show?
Yes, yeah. I am. Like I say, stop it. I don't like to think about it. It's all surreal, and it's, you know, I try to keep my distance from watching what's happening and just worry about the work, because thank God it's a lot of work.
Yeah. That's really true. Ray is one of the most focused people on the work, and that's why the show works.
And you base a lot of your humor on your own family, which
it's my family, it's our executive producer's family, it's our writer's family, it's your family, yeah.
Well, much to your family's dismay sometimes. I mean, you know, your mom's saying, why are you making your brother look so odd? Why are you making him look so crazy?
Well, you know what, in the beginning they had a little problem with it, but they love it now and they joke about it. We did a show once about when my parents were separated, because they were separated in real life, they were separated at one point. And so we did a show about that, and my older brother told me, he goes, I told Dad, you know, Dad, you know, they're doing a show about when you guys were separated. My father looked and went, that bastard will stop at nothing. Is that all right?
Yeah. From you, it's okay.
Yeah. In the context.
Well, congratulations okay. on your third Emmy nomination.
Yeah. yeah.
Well, it's my sixth, actually, and I won one Emmy.
Wow.
I have to bring that up.
Wow, Peter.
Just to be truthful.
There's the monster coming out.
And I hope I see you on Celebrity Survivor.
No.
Yes.
You don't want to see me naked.
There's your doll. Hold it up. One more time before we go.
Hey, Brian!
Peter Boyle and Ray Romano, thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Good to see you again.
Brian?
All right, we got some soup here to pour in his lap. Up next, Gourmet Mallet Magazine celebrates 60 years of good eating. We're back after this.
Thomasville is now at the Home Depot.
Thomasville? Yeah, you got my attention.
Thomasville craftsmanship. Thomasville quality.
It's classy, it's American, it's elegant.
And now for your kitchen or bath, Thomasville cabinetry.
Kitchen cabinets?
Thomasville is great stuff.
Now for kitchens, now for baths, and only at the Home Depot.
Home Depot makes beautiful things portable.
This is why you go to Home Depot first.
Thomasville, exclusively at the Home Depot.
Hey, get off the counter.
The Heartburn Hotel. If you suffer persistent heartburn 2 days a week or more, despite diet change and treatment, it may be acid reflux disease. Prescription Prevacid can mean 24-hour relief from acid reflux disease. Prevacid turns off tiny pumps that produce acid. It has a low occurrence of side effects, such as diarrhea, abdominal pain, and nausea. Ask your doctor if Prevacid is right for you.
So leave your heartburn behind!
Worried about unexpected bills or mounting credit card debt? Log on to DITECH.com or call 1-800-71-FIXED and apply for a second mortgage with DITECH's no closing cost option. With a second mortgage, you may be able to consolidate your high interest debts into one low monthly payment. It's smart money from DITECH.com. Apply online or call us at 1-800-71-FIXED right now.
My daughter has this guy friend. He's a pizza fanatic. He loves Stouffer's French bread pizza. Hot off the plate and crunch. All that cheese and pepperoni? You should see this guy eat.
Stouffer's, nothing comes closer to home.
Listen, they don't want you to know what really happens when you chew that extra polarized gum. It really messes with you, man. Look what it did to my little sister.
Don't do no extra polar ice.
Give me that.
Work is good. Work is noble.
I'm gonna get out there and show them how this job is done.
Packed with protein and essential vitamins and minerals, Carnation Instant Breakfast is the perfect morning fuel to power you up for whatever you've got to do today.
This bird's ready to fly!
Carnation Instant Breakfast from Nestle. Serious morning fuel.
It's been 1 week since you looked at me. 'Cause you heard of the sun and I'm hungry. 5 days since you laughed at me, saying,
"Never gonna come back and see me."
You say you've forgiven me, but it'll still be today till I say I'm sorry.
Ricky, licky, 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 chicken, like vanilla. It's the finest of the flavors. And if you got chocolate, then you know where I go. It's at my door, and then I'll bang your wrist. You'll have to sign a waiver.
I haven't had a tea to wear my mind up asleep.
I haven't had a tea to wear my mind up asleep.
It's been 1 week since you looked at me. Dropped your eyes to the side and said, "I'm sorry."
From spring to fall, it's in the air. It's allergy season. That's why there's Claritin, for 24-hour non-drowsy relief. Claritin has a low occurrence of side effects, such as headache, drowsiness, fatigue, and dry mouth, similar to sugar pill. So from the time you warm up early in the morning, through those extra innings late at night, when the ump yells,
"Play ball!"
you'll be ready. Talk to your doctor about Claritin.
Gourmet Magazine has been chronicling the way folks live and eat since 1941. Now the September anniversary issue of the magazine is celebrating 60 years of gastronomic goodies with some original recipes from years past. Zan Stewart is the executive food editor of Gourmet. My friend, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I was amazed. You know, why would you start a magazine in, not you, but why would they start a magazine in 1941? There was this little thing going on in Europe.
Oh, yes. The incident called the war.
Yes.
It was not the best time to start a magazine, certainly not an Epicurean magazine, but look at us, 60 years later.
Yeah.
You know, it worked.
Really?
And it actually, a lot of magazines dwell in the fantasy realm, and it was a good thing for people.
But Gourmet didn't when it started, right?
No, no, no. Gourmet was very, very rooted in what people in the world eat. And we still are.
Okay. So what was the criteria here when you were choosing recipes to include in this issue?
What tastes good.
Period.
What still tastes good after 60 years.
And you tried to get foods that were representative of the time or were most popular at the time?
Both. Both. I mean, we wanted to be able to make certain statements, but we also wanted food that would translate into today's kitchen.
Okay. Make a statement about the 40s. Why'd you choose lobster thermidor?
Oh, boy. It's just one of those dishes. I remember my grandparents talking about it, and it was a war horse of the 40s. Delicious. But always kind of rich and overdone. I usually like lobster plain, steamed with a little butter.
Yeah.
This
is terribly French.
But this is so good.
Yeah,
it doesn't
pretty
kill
good.
The lobster.
It
it's
is pretty
really
good.
Delicious.
It doesn't kill the lobster? You mean this guy's going to be alive?
No, I mean it doesn't kill the lobster flavor.
Oh, okay.
And then we've got these great mojitos.
Thank you.
Now, you're very welcome. Cheers.
What's in a mojito?
Mojito is white rum, lime juice, mint, and a little sugar muddled all together. People, you know, the kids today think that they invented mojitos. They're in the bars now. They're very popular. My grandparents were drinking mojitos in Havana at Sloppy Joe's in the 40s.
Okay.
It's great, great cocktail.
Are these the children's versions? Did we?
Oh, boy, are you grumpy?
I'm just curious. No, I'm just curious. All right, this is the one you and I are going to fight about, the 50s.
Okay.
The 50s, the decade when people had no imagination. You're going to tell me they were making this soup?
They were making this soup. Boy, and we published this recipe a lot.
Really?
Because of the electric blender. The electric blender.
People used it to make Tang. That's all.
No, the Tang wasn't even around until the 70s. The electric blender was originally a bartender's tool. Fred Waring, the band leader, fell in love with it for making his daiquiris. He popularized this, and it came into the kitchen, and it cut a lot of time out of.
Aren't the 50s the dark ages for food?
Well, frozen foods, I guess, came in, but no, we had good recipes then.
All right, the 60s.
All right, now the 60s must have been 10 years too long for you because cheese fondue was the most popular dish.
Not in my neighborhood.
Not in your neighborhood. Okay, well, it sure was in mine.
All right, what are we drinking with this?
Sangria. Okay. Remember all the sangria parties? Or
yes.
Maybe you don't.
They yes. were.
And
no,
this
no,
was,
that's
this
fine.
Was. We published dozens of recipes for sangria. This one is delicious.
That's better
really,
than mojito.
Really, really good.
Let's move on to the 70s.
The 70s.
Yet another thing with cheese.
Yeah, sorry. It
Janice
wasn't
DeRosa,
my
Kim Williamson, thanks a lot. A lot of great planning there. Go ahead.
Fettuccine Alfredo. When we first published this recipe, we published it with a recipe for making your own pasta because we couldn't get really wonderful, thin pasta in those days. Now we can get it. It's imported. It's beautiful. We've made this with store-bought pasta, but this was when Americans discovered that Italian food didn't have to be just tomato sauce.
Yeah, didn't have to be spaghetti and meatballs. What are we drinking with it?
The kheer. It was, you know, it's a little bit, you know, lighter.
Yeah.
A little foo-foo. A little foo-foo, but it was the 70s.
What do we got here in the 80s?
Okay, we move on. We're still in love. We're still in love with Italy, though. Porcini risotto. It's a beautiful rice dish. Creamy, but it no cream added. A little cheese at the end, and wonderful porcini mushrooms.
And the 90s?
The 90s. The wrap. We reinvented the sandwich using tortillas. Want to help me with it?
Go ahead. You're going to do it.
Okay, now this is something.
You're going to do it. We're going to wind up doing it during a commercial and tasting it at the back end.
Okay. It's a flour tortilla that's been lightly toasted so that it gets fluffy and not all kind of clammy and nasty. A chipotle mayonnaise, because we really want to try to make it up to you after all that cheese, and we know you like chipotle.
Right. And then you're going to put turkey and onions. I'm going to taste some when we come back, Zane.
Okay.
All right, hang on. We're going to take a break right here. 47 past the hour. Back after this.
People always ask me, Whoopi, what's your favorite Entenmann's? Like I'm going to tell them. If I said it was the ultimate crumb cake, they'd go flying off the shelf and there'd be none for me. So I'd never tell anybody what my favorite is. Ever. Entenmann's, what's your favorite?
Thomas's Bagels.
Hi. Thomas's makes bagels?
Nobody makes a fresh bagel like Thomas's. Golden outside, perfect texture inside.
Thomas's makes a great bagel.
Thomas's Bagels.
Thomas's.
Bring it in, fellas. There we go. Come on, hustle up now. Come on. There we go.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Hit the pad. Hit the pad. There we go. There we go.
For a fast appointment with a great doctor, call 202-877-DOCS.
Diamonds. The Jewelry Factory is a direct diamond importer. The Jewelry Factory has thousands of diamonds, most with GIA or EGL certs, laser inscribed and guaranteed the lowest price. 1-carat solitaires are $5.99. 1-carat studs, $3.99. The Jewelry Factory has thousands of rings, pendants, earrings, and bracelets, and specializes in platinum and invisible settings. Only the Jewelry Factory gives you a low price and double value guarantee. Buy Factory Direct, the Jewelry Factory in Bethesda.
CBS Wednesday, the amazing race continues. The teams are off on the next leg of their top secret adventure.
Kevin, don't say anything!
It's the show critics give 4 stars.
Yeah!
A thrilling race around the world.
Oh, God.
More excitement than an Indiana Jones picture.
Get in the damn car!
They're already addicted.
No.
Don't miss the show that takes Survivor off the island and onto the road.
I'm not gonna quit.
The Amazing Race, an all-new episode, CBS Wednesday.
Last May, in a series called Week of Wishes, we asked our viewers to make a wish, big or small, and then we made those dreams come true for 5 lucky people. For those who were chosen, the magic has yet to wear off. If you could have just one wish, what would it be?
Dear Early Show.
Carol Robbins used to be homeless. Her only wish was to thank the man who helped her off the streets.
My boss hired me out of homelessness. I wish for him to have a new set of golf clothes and clubs as repayment.
It's a pleasure to present to you some golf clubs from TaylorMade.
Bill's already put his new clubs to good use, winning his first match in a local tournament.
Crisis Center is advising patients.
Ambulance dispatcher Christy McCluskey helps save lives, but her family feared for her life because she drove an old, worn-out car 100 miles a day to her job. We have a surprise for you.
And for all you do for everyone else, the 2,800 Buick dealers and all the great folks at General Motors want to give you this Buick rendezvous.
GM let her pick her favorite color and interior. To Christy, it rides like a dream come true. The Posey family's rundown mobile home made teenage daughter Amanda especially ashamed.
She does not invite any of her friends over because of what they would think.
Sandra Posey asked for a little fix-up and got a much bigger return.
And we would like to present you with the brand new Fleetwood home, the Waverly Crest. It's a 4-bedroom, 3-bath home. And we hope that you enjoy it for years to come.
Thank you. Oh my gosh, I've never really had any of my friends over, and now I don't have to be embarrassed, you know.
going to have a party.
On Labor Day, the family packed up the last of their possessions from the old trailer and moved into their new home nearby. The baby has plenty of space to play. Amanda now has a new room and friends who visit all the time. Donna Olda's only wish was to fulfill a promise she'd made to her late husband. He wanted his ashes scattered over sacred ground at Wounded Knee, South Dakota. We helped make that happen.
Speechless. The energy, the feeling, the story, everything is just here. I love you, Alan. Rest in peace.
You're on your way to Hawaii. Aloha.
Scott Butler's wish was to see Pearl Harbor, Hawaii before he died. Through the help of a letter written by a family friend, his wish came true. And there's more. Last month, Scott was made an honorary member of the Kentucky State Police and promoted to colonel by the governor himself.
We're proud of you and the courage that you've shown, and we're proud to have you as one of us.
He's been through a lot, and this has been a real uplifting thing for him. Dreams do come true, and Scott is a result of that.
Five letters. Five impossible dreams, five wishes that came true.
Oh, and thank you and so much.
Oh, my goodness.
My goodness. Yeah. Thank you, Brian.
All right.
It was overwhelming.
It's 8:52 here in New York. I'm Brian Thumble. We understand that there has been a plane crash on the southern tip of Manhattan. You're looking at the World Trade Center. We understand that a plane has crashed into the World Trade Center. We don't know anything more than that. We don't know if it was a commercial aircraft. We don't know if it was a private aircraft. We have no idea how many were on board or what the extent of the injuries are right now. We have, I understand, an eyewitness on the phone right now. Sir, what's your name?
Yeah, my name is Stuart.
Stuart, where are you right now?
I'm working at a restaurant in Soho.
All right, so tell us what you saw, if you would.
I was waiting at a table, and I literally saw it seemed to be like a small plane. I just heard a couple noises. It looked like it, like, bounced off the building, and then I just saw a huge, like, ball of fire on top. And then the smoke seemed to simmer down, and it just stung. You know, a lot of smoke was coming out, and that's pretty much the extent of what I saw.
A private aircraft?
I'm not sure if it was a... It just seemed like a smaller plane. I don't think it was anything commercial.
Could you tell us whether or not it was a prop or a jet?
I honestly don't know. It happened too quickly.
Characterize the scene for us down there right now, if you would.
Excuse me?
Can you tell us about the scene down there right now?
Right now, people are just on the street looking at the building. The building, it was just a lot of smoke. It's not too crazy down where I am.
How far away from the World Trade Center specifically are you?
I'm actually on Thompson Street North. I'm not too far.
It's 8:54 right now, Stuart. Can you tell me when this happened exactly?
I would have to say about 10 minutes ago.
About 10 minutes ago?
Yeah.
Is this normally an area that is heavily trafficked by aircraft, or is this an area that that aircraft steer pretty clear of?
You know, I really don't know that information.
Uh-huh. Is there much panic around there?
Just people on the street coming out looking. There was panic at first, but it seemed to slow down right now.
We're looking at a picture of a great deal of smoke coming out of the building. Can you please tell us, I mean, was there, after you heard this crash, was there smoke immediately?
No, there was like a big ball of fire on the top of the building, and then as that simmered down, there just seemed to be a ton of smoke. So pretty much immediately.
I hear fire engines in the background. Has that been going since you saw this crash, or is that kind of late arrival?
It happened almost pretty much after we heard the crash. It was pretty quick when we heard sirens and, you know, people acting on it.
Were you looking up as the plane approached the building, or did it only catch your attention after it crashed into the World Trade Center?
I heard like a sort of a crashing sound. But I looked up quick enough to actually see something go into the building, but everything happened so fast I wasn't quite sure what I was looking at.
So there's no way you can know whether or not the plane seemed to be in trouble before it crashed into the building?
Oh, no, I couldn't tell.
It's hard for us to tell from the picture we're seeing just how far down from the top that plane crashed. Have you any better eyesight to it from your vantage point?
Not really. All I know is it definitely wasn't the top of the building, because that seems to be intact from what I saw. I really can't tell right now.
Can you tell us anything about how much debris came crashing to the ground, and whether or not anybody was hurt as a result?
I honestly don't know. I just saw a lot of what looked like crumbling glass, maybe just a lot of stuff falling down, but not, I can't tell you debris-wise.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, the timing of this is important. It comes before 9 o'clock. Perhaps, and we say that in hopeful fashion, perhaps not everybody was at work, because if that building was in fact crowded with workers, we're looking at probably some casualties and injuries of considerable proportions. But right now there's no way of telling that. Mr. Stewart, just one more time, and I know I'm exhausting what little information you have, but we have people joining us every moment. Take me through again where you were, when this happened, what you saw.
I was serving tables at a restaurant, and I just heard sort of like a boom sound. It almost like an earthquake sound, and I looked up, and I saw literally something like, it might have even bounced off a little bit of a building, and next thing I know, I saw a big ball of fire on the top of the building, and just lots of smoke, and what looked like to be debris or glass falling down, and it happened really quick. It's really hard to...
Okay. Stewart, I thank you very much. I appreciate that, sir.
Okay, my pleasure.
Thank you.
Okay.
We're on the line with another eyewitness. Sir, this is Bryant Gumbel in New York.
Well, how you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. You're Wendell?
Yes, I am.
Wendell, can you give me your last name?
Klein.
Wendell Klein. Tell me where you are, if you would.
Well, right now I'm back in the hotel. I'm in the hotel offices here, the front office.
Okay, where were you
I was standing right in front of the hotel. I'm the doorman there. And
The hotel. Which hotel?
Marriott World Trade Center.
Right across from the World Trade Center.
It's actually right in between them.
Right in between the World Trade Center.
Yes.
Okay, so you were standing outside, and tell us what you saw and what you heard.
Well what I heard first, an explosion. And I just figured that it was a plane passing by. Then all of a sudden, stuff just started falling, like bricks and paper and everything. And so I just kind of like ran like inside to get away from the falling debris and glass and so forth. Then, after like everything stopped, because it like was falling in the street and the cars were crashing through each other, and then when it kind of stopped, I heard a guy screaming. And when I looked over, there was this guy that was on fire. So I kind of like ran over, and I tried to like put the fire out on him. And he was like screaming, and I just told him to roll, and he said he can't. And then another guy came over with his bag and kind of like put the flames out on him. So. Right now, he's being taken care of. I just had everyone call the ambulance and stuff so it can help him out.
He caught fire as a result of the falling debris?
Yeah.
How much debris, can you give us an idea of how much came crashing to the ground?
It's just a lot. Bricks, a lot of bricks, a lot of glass. I'm like, enough to like damage cars on the street, make cars swerve into each other, that kind of thing.
Any other people on the ground that you saw?
No, just
hurt?
Just him so far.
Tell me about the traffic down in that area, and I'm talking about human traffic.
Human traffic, well...
At 8:55,
well,
which is about the time when this happened, 8:45, 8:55.
Right. On my side, where I'm standing, there's not a whole lot, because it's basically right in front of the hotel, so you don't get too much, but you do get enough, you know, get some.
What about traffic in the building? I mean, you work basically between the two towers.
Yes.
Most people arriving for work before or after 9 a.m.?
Before. Basically, in my hotel, I have people who are just leaving and going to meetings. Outside my hotel, I just have people waiting for their cars to take them to their various destinations, that kind of thing.
I hear alarms going off down there. What's happening?
That's our hotel alarm, and basically, I guess that went off automatically. They've evacuated everyone in the hotel, and evacuated all employees.
They have evacuated the hotel?
Yes.
Immediately?
Yes.
Can you give me an idea of what the scene is like down there? What the scene is like down there at the World Trade Center?
Just people are like crying and panicking, like want to know what's going on. When I came inside, there were a lot of people who wanted to go out to see what was going on, but the security kind of like kept them at bay and kept them inside. Basically, right now, I just still have people going towards the bar area. They're trying to evacuate everyone out of here, that kind of thing.
Is this an area, Mr. Klein, that is normally trafficked by small planes, or is it an area that they're generally steer clear of?
You do get some. I do see some passing. Basically, those planes, like I do see passing, are like those, like the planes from Washington, D.C. area. Mm-hmm. Like, so there won't be like huge planes, but, you know, big enough.
Mm-hmm. Are you hearing anything, Wendell, about what kind of a plane it was?
No.
Or
no.
How many were on board?
No. No, basically all I got was my wife called me. She told me that it was a plane crash, and basically I really don't know what's going on so far.
Do you know if it was a private aircraft or a commercial plane?
That I don't know.
You don't know?
No, sir.
You're not seeing any evidence of people being carried out of the building yet?
There's a woman that was just carried. I guess she fainted or something, but I don't see any physical injuries to her.
All right. Mr. Klein, thank you very much, sir.
All right. Good talking to you, sir.
I appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
I understand Teresa Renault is with us right now. Ms. Renault, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
This is Bryant Gumbel. I'm down on 59th and 5th. Where are you?
I am in Chelsea, and we are at 8th and 16th. We are the tallest building in the area, and my window faces south. So it looks directly onto the World Trade Center. And I would say, you know, approximately 10 minutes ago, there was a major explosion from probably, it looks like about the 80th floor. It looks like it's affected probably 4 to 8 floors. Major flames are coming out of the north side and also the east side of the building, yes. And it was very loud explosion followed by flames, and it looks like the building is still on fire on the inside.
Which building are we talking about? The one that's westernmost?
Let's see. Yes, sir.
So it's coming out on the north side and the east side of the building in the westernmost tower.
That's correct.
You're over in Chelsea. Did you hear the explosion from your position?
Yes, we did. As a matter of fact, we heard it and. Because I was just like standing there pretty much looking out the window. I didn't see what caused it or if there was an impact.
So you have no idea right now?
Oh, there's another one. Another plane just hit. Right? Oh, my God. Another plane has just hit. It hit another building. Flew right into the middle of it. Explosion. My God, it's right in the middle of the building.
This one into the east tower.
Yes. Yes. Right in the middle of the building. And right now... That was definitely looked like it was on purpose.
You saw a plane?
Yes, I just saw a plane go into the building.
Why do you say that was definitely on purpose?
Because it just flew straight into it. It didn't look like it was, and it didn't look like a commercial jet. It was a smaller plane. It was definitely a smaller plane.
Can you characterize the scene down there right now for us?
Now on the...
Yeah, as you can look down to the street
from
your vantage point.
On the second building, I think that we, the further one, the east side, there it is. Looks like it's about, I would say, 15 floors lower than the first building, and there is now flames coming out of that building as well. They're both completely on fire.
Now, I'm looking at what was the West Tower, and it looks like the fire on the north side of that tower is a little bit lower, but it looks like it's the same building. You're saying it was the other tower that absorbed the second
impact?
That's
what it looks like, exactly, from my perspective.
Don King, our director, if I could ask you to widen out and give us a shot of both towers, because we can't tell from this vantage point. Oh, okay, that is on the second tower.
Yes.
It is on the east tower. Teresa, hang on with us 1 second. We're gonna re-rack the tape of when we were talking to you to see if we can tell.
Okay.
We can't see anything. We can't see a second plane in the picture. There we see the explosion.
Yes.
There we see the explosion.
It was definitely a plane that hit it.
Here we are. We're trying to re-rack the tape right now. Teresa, do you have a vantage point to the ground from where you are?
Yes, I probably could go down.
No, I'm not asking you to go down.
Okay.
I'm asking if you can see it.
Oh, no, I cannot see the ground, as a matter of fact. There's too many buildings in the way. I can probably see just up about, I would say, up a third of, I can see the top two-thirds of the building.
Uh-huh. And how much of that top two-thirds do you see flames? Do you see damage?
I would say middle of the second building and the top fourth of the first building.
Okay, Teresa, stay with us. We're going to look for that tape one more time.
Okay.
We're going to re-rack the tape here and see if we can't see a plane. Yeah, we see it right now. We see a plane right now coming in and impacting on what would appear to be the north side of that tower, of the westernmost tower, and hitting about 10 to 15 stories below. Teresa, let me ask you to hang on with us for a second while I talk with another gentleman who is an eyewitness, Richard Davis. Mr. Davis, good morning.
Good morning.
This is Bryant Gumbel.
Yes, sir.
I'm at 59th and 5th. Where are you?
I'm at 50th and 5th, but I'm facing south on the 39th floor.
You're facing south, so you have a clear vantage point.
Yes.
Talk to me about what you see, if you could.
The first plane looked like a 737. It would flew right up the middle of Manhattan. It was clearly too low. I noticed it by the time it was passing the Empire State Building, and noticed that it was too low. It was appeared to be absolutely nothing wrong with the plane, and then it very deliberately flew into the side of the World Trade Center.
Why do you say very deliberately?
Because the pilot aimed right for the building, and there was nothing wrong with the plane.
The plane did not appear to be in any trouble whatsoever?
None whatsoever.
And we're talking about a commercial aircraft, a 737?
It appeared to be a 737. I can't be absolutely certain.
No, obviously, I'm not asking you to be an aviation expert, but clearly what you saw, or what you say you saw, was not a small aircraft.
It was not a small aircraft. It was a small commercial aircraft, like a small Airbus or a 737 Boeing.
And that was the
two
first plane?
Two-engine jet.
Did you see, Mr. Davis, we're looking at a tape replay of the second plane boring into the building. Hard for us to tell exactly how large an aircraft it is there, or whether or not that was intentional. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Believe me, it was intentional. We saw the second one come up the Hudson and veer into the second building.
Why do you say the second was intentional?
Because it was flown very deliberately. There appeared to be nothing wrong with the aircraft. It was flown very deliberately into the building.
Have they, you don't, obviously you're at 50th, you don't have any vantage point down there. What's everybody else talking about there who has the same vantage point? They see all the same thing you did?
Yes. Well, others did not see the first one, but there were several people in my office when the second one came in.
Yeah, we're looking at the second one boring in right now, and it does not seem to be wavering in any way or seem to be banking to avoid the tower in any way.
Let us say it could hardly be a coincidence. The two airplanes fly into the World Trade Center within minutes of each other.
Yeah.
On a clear day.
Yeah. It's a terrible scene right now.
Yes, the towers are look terrible.
Wow. Wow. Ms. Renault, are you still on with me? Therese Renault?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Can you tell us if the scene has changed from your vantage point?
I would say from my vantage point right now, it's looks like there are very, very few flames coming out of the first tower, still a lot of smoke. The second tower, we can still see flames coming out of the window, the north window, and a lot of smoke. A lot of smoke. The tops of the building are covered in smoke.
And from your vantage point, you can't see anything of what's happening on the ground?
No, I cannot. I hear a lot of sirens out on the street right now. One thing that you can see in the windows is all of the emergency system lights. That was one thing we could see. All of them were blinking off and on in the first tower when that happened. And I can't see them anymore. The second tower, I cannot see any emergency lights in the building blinking.
All right. I'm going to thank you both right there and pass along the word that we are getting from the FBI that at this point the FBI is trying to confirm that this was an intentional act. At this point, it's pure speculation. Mr. Davis has told us of what he saw and that it appeared the first plane, a large aircraft, bored into the westernmost of the two towers in intentional fashion. While we were speaking moments ago, a second plane, hard to identify the size of it, bored its way into the easternmost tower. So we have two crashes. Here's a different angle of the same plane. You see it off there on the left, boring into there. But again, at this point, it is restricted airspace. It is a clear day, so the suspicions are high that these are intentional acts. But the FBI at this point is still trying to confirm that these are intentional acts. We have another eyewitness on the phone. Sir, good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Gumbel.
How are you?
I'm fairly frightened, I have to say.
Give me your name, if you would.
My name is Frederick Schneider, sir.
Mr. Schneider, where are you?
I am on Liberty Street, which is the same street that the Trade Center's on. I'm on the south side, and the Trade Center's on the north side. My office is on the 24th floor, so I have a very clear view of exactly what happened this morning, and I've been here for about 2 hours, so I've been watching it unfold.
2 hours?
Yes. I got to my office at 7 this morning.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. But tell me about the timetable of when things started to go terribly bad this morning.
Well, Mr. Gumbel, at about 8:50 this morning, there was an explosion. I heard it first, and then my building, which is 51 stories tall, shook and rocked, and then I saw a plume of flame shoot out of the Trade Center over the Hudson River, and then I saw the plane that had crashed into the Trade Center fall down, and then it disappeared behind a building that blocks my view. There was a tremendous amount of smoke, and then it started to rain huge pieces of paper, and the paper continued to come down. At that point, all the news media started to learn about it, and I turned on my radio, and while I was still sitting at my desk, I saw a second jet, fairly large plane, fly in over the south end of Manhattan and deliberately fly directly into the Trade Center before my eyes.
Why do you say deliberately fly into the Trade Center?
Because there was no doubt in my mind that both planes were using the Trade Center as a target. They weren't in trouble.